Welcome to another Deck Tech from the Trinisphere, where Timmy, Johnny, and Spike battle over all things EDH. I am Shannon the Johnny, and I'm here to talk about Ashaya, Soul of the Wild, and a Deck Tech I'm calling Ashaya Dorkstorm. Ashaya, Soul of the Wild is a 5-mana star-star. Power and toughness are equal to the number of lands we control, but non-token creatures we control are forests in addition to their other types. What? That is bananas. So this card turns all of our creatures effectively into Llanowar Elves. They can be tapped for green. They are lands in addition to other types. This is a pretty sweet-ass card. It's really busted, in my opinion. So I'm calling this deck Ashaya Dorkstorm because I just want to play as many Llanowar Elves as I possibly can. And Ashaya turns any generic 1-mana creature into a Llanowar Elf. So the first thing that comes to mind as a way to really abuse a deck that would have 30-plus Llanowar Elves is the card Cloudstone Curio. This 3-mana artifact says whenever a non-artifact permanent enters the battlefield under our control, we may bounce another permanent that shares a type with it to our hand. So we can use this in conjunction with cards that give haste, like Concordant Crossroads. This is kind of a traditional one with Curio. This means that whenever we play a Llanowar Elves, we can bounce an Elvish Mystic to our hand. We can tap that Llanowar Elves for a green to recast that Elvish Mystic. When Elvish Mystic comes into play, it triggers Cloudstone Curio to bounce the Llanowar Elves to our hand. Now we can tap Elvish Mystic for a green to replay Llanowar Elves. We've demonstrated a loop that gives us an infinite number of creature falls, or creatures entering the battlefield, and an infinite number of land falls in the presence of Ashaya, because those are also forests in addition to the other types. So now with this loop and Ashaya, not only are generic 1-mana creature another Llanowar Elf, but it's also creating infinite landfall triggers in addition to creature fall triggers. It also makes other cards work like Cloudstone Curio. Cards like Quirion Ranger and Scrib Ranger are excellent in this deck. Quirion Ranger is a 1-mana 1/1 that says return a forest we control to our hand to untap target creature, and we can only use this ability once each turn. However, in the presence of Ashaya, Quirion Ranger is itself a forest, which means Quirion Ranger can return itself to our hand to untap another creature. Now combine this with a haste enabler. Quirion Ranger now says, when I'm in play, tap me for green, then bounce me to your hand to untap another creature. Now use that green to replay me, and rinse and repeat. So now we have an infinite number of creature falls, an infinite number of land falls, and an infinite number of untapped target creatures. Scrib Ranger also can do this kind of thing, but it costs 2 mana instead of 1. It's a little more difficult to pay off its own cost to recast it. However, we have plenty of stuff in this deck to improve our mana production from loop to loop. So now that we can see that we're focusing on an infinite number of creature falls and land falls, how do we leverage that, turn that into a win? Now, as being a Johnny, I like to win with obscure and or terrible cards. The worse the card, the more delicious the win. I'm going to use things like Bantu's Monument. This 3-mana legendary artifact says black creatures cost 1 less to cast, so is irrelevant, but says whenever we cast a creature spell, drain each opponent for 1, or they lose a life and we gain a life. This is effectively an artifact version of the Corpse Knight, which I also like to play in other decks. So Bantu's Monument, in the presence of the infinite looping of Quirion Ranger or the Llanowar Elf, Mystic Elf, Bounce Team, we'll drain all of our opponents to death immediately. Now, we don't even have to go infinite for Bantu's Monument to win. It's very possible for this list to produce 20 to 30 raw dog new 1-1 creatures in a single turn, thus killing everyone. Additionally, we have Ronus's Monument. This 3-mana legendary artifact says green creatures we cast cost 1 less to cast, which is also kind of irrelevant in our deck because everything in this deck is just a single green. Whenever you cast a creature spell, target creature you control gets a +2/+2 and gains trample until end of turn. So this is useful into pumping Ashaya into an enormous monstrosity with trample. It often would be like a 45-45 with trample because we just played like 7-1-1, 8-1-1s, giving it +16, +14, +16 easily. It also is really funny to use those +2s on unrandom creatures, turning them all into almighty brushwags or charging badgers. Being able to punch somebody down with a 15-15 Llanowar Elf is a lot of fun, let me tell you. Now, if you're into more something that is a little less janky, we have Baru, Fist of Krosa. This 5-mana human druid is a 4-4 that says whenever a forest comes into play, green creatures we control get a +1/+1 and trample until end of turn. So every time we play any creature, which in the presence of Ashaya is also a forest, whenever we basically landfall forest, it pumps all of our board for +1/+1 and trample. So we can chain together maybe 6 or 7 1 drops, and all of a sudden Baru has pumped our board by +6/+6 and trample. March of the Dorks. Now, one important thing about this deck is we're going to be able to play a lot of mana dorks in a single turn, and we're going to need haste so that we can use them immediately. So, of course, we talked about Concordant Crossroads, the king of Cloudstone Curio shenanigans. This 1-mana enchantment gives all creatures haste, which is a little dangerous. We got to remember to not play this card and then pass to our opponents. It's a great way to get knocked out by a surprise Blightsteel Colossus. So, what we want to do is we want to play this enchantment when we're ready to win the game. Or, we can try and chain through our deck using our draw engines to try and find Concordant Crossroads to pull off the win then and there. Akroma's Memorial is a another haste enabler. This is a big old 7-mana legendary artifact. And while haste is the most important part of this card, it does have plenty of other stuff, including giving our creatures flying, first strike, vigilance, trample, and prot black, prot red. Most of those won't really come into play for what we're trying to do, but if you're going to take a more of a Timmy slant on this and want to punch people to death more often than not, giving creatures flying, trample, and vigilance is very good. It makes it impossible for people to crack back at us. It also makes it hard for them to block the army of dorks. And then having some protection is pretty nice too. I have definitely won a game using a Chroma's Memorial in play. They board wiped me and I just recast a Shia, popped out a bunch of mana dorks and swung for lethal right then and there. Now, Lightning Greaves and Thousand Year Elixir are other really good haste enablers when it comes to pulling off the combo, but not so much for the Timmy swing. Lightning Greaves now can be used in conjunction. We play a new mana dork, we equip Greaves to it, and we tap it for that green. We use that green to play a new mana dork, we move Greaves to it and tap it for a green. We can use that to chain our way down the line to cast a bunch of creatures, but when we go to combat, only one of them can wear the Greaves at a time. Thousand Year Elixir similarly gives all our mana dorks the ability to tap for green, however does not give them the ability to attack. So these can be used to pull our combo off to trigger all of our effects a bunch of times, but we're going to need Concordant Crossroads if we plan on swinging for game. Gingerbrute and Noctabi Trach are two one-drop creatures that have haste, so they're notable in this deck because even without any of these haste-enabling effects, these creatures come down with haste, can swing, can tap for mana immediately then and there in the presence of Shia. Now, a lot of the times is how the deck is going to work is we're going to play a ton of mana dorks and tap them for mana. So when we comboed off, what it's going to look like is most of our board is tapped 1/1 creatures, and some of them may be buffed by Baru, by Ronus. We're going to want to untap all those creatures if we plan on swinging for game, or if we just want to continue the chain going for mana production purposes. So Cloudstone Curio is kind of one of our jankier ways to untap creatures. It effectively untaps them by unsummoning to our hand and then replaying them untapped. So it's kind of a roundabout and cost inefficient way to untap all of our creatures. We have some better ones. Nettle Sentinel. This 1-mana 2/2 says, I don't untap on your untap step. However, when you play a green spell, untap me, which is insane. We can shortcut this in our brains to think that whenever we play a green spell, we get a green mana. Nettle Sentinel will tap for a green, then untap itself. So it's just a free green mana every time we cast a green spell. So if we're already casting a mana dork and that has haste, Nettle Sentinel is adding additional green into the pile. That's basically infinite mana. If we can recast those guys over and over and over and over and over again, Nettle Sentinel is adding extra green to the pool, giving us infinite mana. Gurion Ranger and Scrib Ranger we talked about earlier helps us untap other things. So similarly, in the presence of mana dorks coming in and out of the battlefield over and over again, these are untapping other creatures to produce mana, thus generating infinite mana. Wirewood Symbiote is the third iteration of these rangers. Unfortunately, it's not infinite because it cannot return itself to our hand. It can only return an elf, and it is in fact an insect. However, it's still good as a one-shot way to untap another creature, produce a little extra mana, allow us to replay a creature, get another trigger, etc., etc. Also, we have Stone Cedar Hierophant and Magus the Candelabra. Stone Cedar is an awesome creature. This 4-mana 1/1 says, landfall untap me, and I have the ability to tap to untap target land. Of course, with Ashaya, all of our creatures are land, so whenever we play a creature, Stone Cedar Hierophant can untap target land or creature. So Stone Cedar Hierophant, another way to go infinite, add infinite mana on top of the pool, but also very good untapping things like Gaia's Cradle and Nykthos. So even without like some shenanigans going down, we can still just use this, untap Gaia's Cradle, float another 7 mana, play a mana dork, untapping Stone Cedar. Well, we're going to use it to untap Gaia's Cradle again, etc., etc., getting out of hand really quickly. For our one-shot untap effects, we have Benefactor's Draft and Copperhorn Scout. Benefactor's Draft is more of like our stand-in dramatic reversal. Once we've played out a huge board of creatures, we can use Benefactor's Draft to untap all of our creatures and maybe swing for lethal, or just keep the combo going. Use them all to tap for mana again. Copperhorn Scout uses our combat step in order to untap everything, so if you're a Timmy, you're probably not going to want to use this as much. Whenever it attacks, we untap each other creature we control full stop. So we can send this one into the red zone to its death in order to untap all of our mana dorks so that on main phase 2 we can try and combo again. For ramp removal and draw, we're going to run every mana dork we can get our hands on. Llanowar Elves, Elvish Mystic, Finhorn Elves, and Birds of Paradise are our staples. We're also going to run Arbor Elf because in this deck it can untap other creatures when a Shy is in play. We're going to run Arboreal Grazer and Elvish Pioneer, both one-drop creatures that can get an extra land drop early game. We're going to run Boreal Druid. That makes the cut. Even though it can't tap to produce the green needed to pay another dork, it helps us get a Shia down a turn earlier. And once a Shia is down, Boreal Druid is now also a force, so now it can tap for green. Lotus Cobra and Nissa Who Shakes the World double our mana production effectively. Lotus Cobra says whenever one of our land dorks enters the battlefield, produce another green. And then Nissa Who Shakes the World says whenever we attack one of our land dorks, we add an additional green to the pool. So these ones really help enable those infinite loops generating infinite mana or just positive net mana production in order to chain through our deck and play a huge amount of creatures in a single turn. Cryptolith Rite provides a backup to a Shaya in case a Shaya were to be destroyed too many times or maybe stolen and or neutralized. Cryptolith Rite, of course, does not turn our creatures into land, so we lose a little bit of the strength of this deck, but it's still quite possible with this deck to pull off wins using just Cryptolith Rite, giving every single creature Birds of Paradise's ability. So Kurtribe Scout and Sky Shroud Ranger are two creatures that say tap me to put a land from hand into play. So these are slightly worse than generic mana dorks because once we run out of lands and we tap those lands, they can't produce much more mana. But once a Shy is in play, they become mana dorks. And also diversifying our ramp into lands makes us a little bit more resilient to board wipes that destroy all of our mana-based dorks. For removal, we're going to run some jankier fun stuff like Elvish Lyrist, Elvish Scrapper, and Scavenger Foe, cards I don't think ever really get played outside of maybe Elf Ball. These cards are just one drops with upside, so I'm definitely going to jam them in here. We're also going to run the traditional caustic Caterpillar, Reclamation Sage, Beast Within, Return to Nature, and then also Force of Vigor to round out our options for destroying artifacts and enchantments. Uvenwald Tracker gives us a little bit of creature removal. It works well with a Shaya, who is often enormous, the biggest creature on the battlefield, but it also can be used with things like Wasteland Viper, who have Death Touch, which is slithering around in the back of this list. Draw is very important in this deck when we're storming off, because if we're not going to be using an infinite loop with Cloudstone Curio, which we can, we're going to be trying to draw into more new one drops. So Glimpse of Nature is an auto include in this deck. It's absolutely a house. This card sets up a game-winning turn more often than not, and it says whenever we cast a creature spell, we draw a card. So it's basically like a one-mana Guardian Project that lasts for a single turn. Speaking of which, we're going to run Guardian Project along with Beast Whisperer and the Great Henge. These are our more traditional stable draw engines. The Great Henge is a little tough to pull off considering the average creature in our deck is a 1-mana 1-1, but a Shy is way more than a 7-7 on average. So you can expect Great Henge to cost just green-green, and of course it has that sweet ability that says whenever a non-token creature enters a battlefield in our control, put a counter on it and draw a card. So another great draw engine. Lifecrafter's Bestiary and Primordial Sage are going to be our less cost-effective draw engines. Lifecrafter's Bestiary requires a green to draw a card, and Primordial Sage costs 6 to pull off, but you've seen with the Lotus Cobra, with the Nissa Who Shakes the World, etc., Lifecrafter's Bestiary is definitely serviceable here in this list. Shamanic Revelations provides a nice burst of draw power, allowing us to draw for every mana dork we have in play, and gain some life with a giant ass, a Shaya, and maybe a Primordial Sage being in play as well. Hazardous Monument is going to make the cut. This 3-mana legendary effect says red creature spells we cast cost 1 less to cast, irrelevant, but most importantly, whenever you cast a creature spell, you may discard a card, and if you do, draw a card. I do love these rummage effects, especially these passive, easily triggerable ones. Now we're able to filter our draws, make sure that we can effectively draw into more mana dorks and less lands, filter out those land draws that could potentially fizzle our combo as we're going off. Nissa Vital Force is a really cool planeswalker, often underrated. This 5-mana 5 loyalty planeswalker's most important facet is that it can ult in the turn after it comes into play. The first turn it comes into play, it uses its +1 to untap target land we control, and until our next turn it becomes a 5-5 elemental creature with haste, it's still a land. Now it's at 6 loyalty and can immediately be used in the following turn for its emblem, which says, whenever a land enters the battlefield under your control, you may draw a card, which is exactly why we're playing this one. As Shaya turns all of our creatures into lands, this emblem says whenever you play a creature or land, draw a card, which is insane. The +1 is also still very good in this list. Untap target land we control, which in our list is also our creatures, and it becomes a 5-5 elemental with haste. So it can untap a creature and give it haste. It can untap a land, turn it into a 5-5. It can turn a dork into a 5-5. But most importantly, we're just trying to find a means to get that emblem as quick as possible. And lastly, we're going to run Vizier the Menagerie, the 4-mana 3-4 that lets us look at the top card of our library and cast the top card if it's a creature card. Great way to just play dorks off the top of our library. We can use that in conjunction with the Hazard's Monument to filter out those pesky lands that can fizzle our combos. Now outside of the combo, if we're not able to pull it off, we're getting slowed down, it's not going off fast enough, we can just try and beat people to death. We talked about Baru and the Almighty Brushwag, but we also have in here a Scythe Leopard, Scoot Swarm, Hex Drinker, and Ovia Pashari. Scythe Leopard is just a 1-1 that has landfall, put a +1/+1 on me until end of turn, and that gets out of hand very quickly. I've swung with this as a 17-17 pretty consistently. Scoot Swarm is an insane card. I don't know if you all know about this. Have you ever heard about this thing, this Scoot Swarm? It's kind of been making a splash a bit in other formats. This card is absolutely busted. It has a multiplicative approach to its proliferation. Every time we play a creature that is also a land, the Scoot Swarms just start multiplying, and I've gotten it to some pretty large triple-digit numbers very easily. Hex Drinker is just a really cool card that I've always wanted to play. This 1-mana level up creature, it starts out as a 2-1, but and its final form becomes a 6-6 with protection from everything, which is hilarious. Now, Avio Pashari is a 1-mana 1-2, so it's already better than the average, but it has a 5-mana activated ability that says put an XX colorless construct artifact creature token in play, where X is the number of creatures we control. That gives us another another way to produce giant fatties that can be used to fight via Uvenwald Tracker, or maybe to cost reduce the Great Henge, or to gain life through Shamanic Revelation. Any deck list like this that's so heavily dependent upon the commander to function, I'm going to run a few protection spells to help us out. Heroic Intervention protects us from board wipes, making sure none of our dorks get wiped out, but it can also be used to counter targeted spot removal. Similarly, Sylvan Safekeeper can target spot removal by sacrificing lands, which in this deck could also be dorks. So pretty nice that everything in our deck ends up being a devoted bodyguard. Veil of Summer is a one-mana instant that says draw a card if an opponent casts a blue or black spell this turn. Then spells we control can't be countered, and also permanents we control have hexproof from black and blue. So this might be a little narrow and that only affects a certain set of colors, which I usually don't like to play in EDH, but I think this card is valuable enough to run just for being counter-counter. Lastly, let's talk about the utility cards. Cards that didn't really fit in the other categories, which are really great in this list. Constant Mist is a fog, 2 mana, prevent all combat damage. It has buyback, sack a land, which in our list, of course, means buyback, sack a land or a creature. So I can see in a lot of matchups, if you can show to your opponent that they can never hit you because you can just sack a mana dork to buyback this spell, that they might just concede on the spot. Creeping Renaissance is a 5 mana sorcery that says choose a permanent type. In our case, it'll be creatures. Return all of those, all the chosen type from graveyard to hand. And this has flashback 7. So this is a great way post board wipe to return all the dorks into our hand. And if our Great Henge or Guardian Project survive the board wipe, then we're about to combo off again and immediately after getting board wiped. Elvish Reclaimer helps us go fetch Gaia's Cradle and Nykthos by being kind of what I call a crop rotation spell shaper, able to sack a land to search our library for any land card and put it into play. Jotty Offshoot and Essence Warden provide us life gain, allow us to just tank an enormous amount of damage in the early game. People will be like, wow, I'm pretty sure you're going to block with your dorks. And you're like, no, I'm not. I'm just going to take all the damage. Because once I start to combo off, if I hit an Essence Warden, I'm going to gain 30 life in a single turn. Spore Frog and Wasteland Viper can just straight up deter attacking. Spore Frog being a fog on a stick, and Wasteland Viper being a death toucher. I also like Wasteland Viper in this list because I can use it as a sort of janky berserk. When we swing with an Ashaya Soul of the Wild that has Trample, our opponents are going to just pile a bunch of creatures in front of it in order to try and prevent taking lethal commander damage. Then we just Blood Rush our Wasteland Viper onto the Ashaya. Now Ashaya only needs to assign one damage to each blocker because that ends up being lethal when you have Death Touch, and the rest of the damage tramples through. So all of a sudden, this stupid 1-mana 1-2 Death Toucher just allowed Ashaya to one-shot somebody. Lastly, we're going to use Eternal Witness as a means to return our Ashaya to our hand if it gets destroyed too many times and you don't want to pay the tax, or it can be used to go grab Shamanic Revelation, Beast Within, or any various other cards in order to keep our combos churning. All right, that's a wrap on this list. What do you think about this Ashaya Dorkstorm? I gotta tell you, I love this list. I love playing it. The idea of killing people with 1-mana 1-1 dorks, it just really appeals to my Johnny side. It's resilient and it's a ton of fun. And most of all, it's one of those decks that where the combo is not necessarily infinite, so a lot of people get to watch you play out your deck. All right, that's a wrap for Shannon the Johnny's Ashaya Dorkstorm. Let me know what you think in the comments. Be sure to like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon if you want to see more traditional staple-heavy beatdown decks from Timmy, or you want to see something a little more competitive and interactive from Spike. This is Shannon the Johnny signing off. Great minds, brew alike.